This is an English version of Oral Stealth's video, which you can check out in this video's cards and description. I really enjoy games like Dead Cells, The Binding of Isaac, and Slay the Spire. These are my favourite games from the roguelite genre. A few years ago, I made a procedurally generated aim map for CSGO, but in my heart, what I really wanted to make was a full-featured roguelite. I had already started on it even back then, and today I am happy to finally share it with you. Fortunately for you, but unfortunately for this game mode, Counter-Strike 2 is here and acts as this project's main villain. It's certainly a gift to fans of the game series, with its Source 2 engine, its new features, and so on. But rather understandably, it is disastrous news for my new game mode that I've spent the last 3 years developing. Undertaking such an ambitious project was a daunting prospect, so it started life as just a small aim map that generates an enclosed layout and item placement within a confined, manageable area. Not what you'd hope for from procedural level generation, but it served its purpose well, helping me to practice my scripting skills, and it seems like many of you still enjoyed the result. Next, I decided upon a wingman mode to serve as a sensible stepping stone on the way towards my ultimate goal of creating a fully-fledged roguelite. I used this to investigate the limitations of scripting for Counter-Strike, because if some things proved impossible, then there would be no point in going any further. For example, with wingman mode, it's fun to be able to change the size of the bombsite, because it's boring if it's the same all the time. Fortunately, CSGO allows for you to change this sort of thing, but bots prove to be the limiting factor, and the more you change the circumstances, the less the chances are that they'll actually be able to plant the bomb. The bot's navigation mesh in general is a secondary, but still important, consideration. I went about getting it working for this game mode by splitting their movement grid up into very small squares, with many of these being obstructed by procedurally generated details, and then what's left becomes their routes across the level. This was more or less fine. Other than that, I focused on making the generated details look more varied and prettier than in previous iterations by including more varieties of items, buildings, decorative elements, and, most importantly, plant types. I battled with various teething issues along the way, with unexpected bugs and unpredictable restrictions, but I eventually produced a playable wingman map in which the sites, the spawns, passages, and its environments were randomly and successfully generated every time. However, something still seemed off about the result. I didn't enjoy it, and ultimately decided to put the project on hold, in the hope that one day I'd get the divine inspiration that was required to help finish it to a standard that I was happy with. Sadly, I'm still waiting for that day, so until that happens, my Wingman project's fate remains uncertain. While developing that Wingman project, I was doing a couple of paid projects on the side. One of these was a request for a training room of sorts, which was an idea I had had previously, but it was the paid element that finally encouraged me to attempt it. I realised it would be the ideal project to combine with my procedurally generated scripts, and I enjoyed combining the two to produce a training room that changes with every playthrough. It comprised of different rooms strung together, inside each of which were places to spawn items, mostly boxes. Behind them, bots could appear, which you needed to shoot in order to gain points. I was happy with the result, because I had finally generated more than one room at once, which helped me to decide that I was finally ready to undertake my dream project of a roguelite experience. So, after a few years of experimentation, I finally got on to making a roguelite game mode with the ability to play both solo and with friends, complete with pickups, unlockables, shops, unique enemies, abilities, and bosses. It's funny that initially I planned to make this mode for the 10th anniversary of CSGO, but in the end, it turned out to be a farewell gift to a passing era. But first things first, how do we get this working on a game engine that's bound by so many restrictions? As with the Wingman map, first I needed to make sure that I could get the essentials working. Firstly, the damage rewrite. I wanted the weapons in this mode to deal damage differently from how they do in Counter-Strike, because the player's stats would be getting upgraded as the experience progressed, so it was important to also be able to make the bots the players would be facing more challenging and more lethal in each successive location played. This seems like an impossible challenge, because if you were to get shot in the head with an AWP, it is most likely a one-hit kill, before any damage modifications could occur to reverse that. Luckily, in CSGO, I found a workaround. Health is displayed on screen up to a maximum of 32,767. So what happens if we set the player's health to 32,768? I hear you cry. Well, setting it to that makes the section of the HUD displaying your health to suddenly disappear. It's like it thinks the player's dead or something. but setting it one higher again to 32,769 makes it look like we have just 1 HP again, when in fact the total is so great that we can survive even a whole pint of lead. And this is how the damage rewriting works. I boost the player's health to beyond 32,768, which then gives me control over how much damage should be inflicted, depending on a number of rogue game mode related factors like difficulty level, luck, and much more. And since the health levels are so high, there's no risk of the player dying as the calculations are being performed. This trickery isn't noticeable to the player, and is a system that was essential to get a rogue-style game mode working. Secondly, there are items in this game mode that give players a buff, so it was important to implement an inventory system that correctly collects, stores, and displays the player's stats and abilities. Fortunately, this was implemented without a hitch, the only negative being that CSGO does not provide good tools for editing the existing HUD. This instead has to be implemented via visible tooltips, or with text, but this doesn't scale well to higher resolutions. A fancy alternative to these approaches is to attach custom assets to the player's camera, but even this isn't without a bitter downside. I chose to feature some of the interface using this method, but the player must remain still because during movement, everything attached to him will shake in a distracting manner, which is a pity because this could have been the ideal solution to creating a brand new user-friendly interface for my game mode. The third challenge was adding a save system. A roguelite experience can last several hours, so the idea of having to do that without a save system is just wow. Fortunately, CSGO has some tricks I could utilize to save files and then to load from them by reading from them again. This method is far from ideal, but it's better than nothing. Saves work automatically and save the player's progress on each load of a new level. So if the game crashes, your stats may be reset, but your earned experience points remain, which you can then spend again the next time you load the map up. And the fourth, and most important challenge to overcome, was the level generation. Let me remind you that the room in the aim map was simple, with the whole generation process being the mere placement of predetermined items. In the training map, the generation was more complicated, with multiple rooms being combined to form a long corridor, complete with objects appearing in certain places. But for a roguelite game mode, it was necessary to come up with something a lot more advanced. I tried several options, finally settling on the following. A room gets divided into a floor and separate walls. The floor model stores data about the edges of the room and any potential exits. And the wall models have different designs and lengths. You can see from this farm theme that each wall has many sub-models which allow for a huge variety in appearance. And the best thing about it is that this is all contained within just one model. This greatly reduces the number of props required per area, which is important when the total number I can have is so limited. This method of room generation allows me to connect two different floors in one room, from which there can be several entrances and exits, around which walls can be built. The result is an elaborate corridor containing many different rooms, some of which have branches, some leading to shops or to rooms with desirable items in them. This was made possible thanks to Blender, which I had to learn for this project. I only needed to figure out a few basic things, like how to create simple models, simple animations, primitive bone creation, and how to modify existing assets, which helped with many different aspects of developing this game mode. The generation of items in previous projects was relatively simple. I arranged a set of boxes and barrels in advance in a level like this, and put triggers in places to ensure that only the right types of items were spawned there. This severely limited the variety of the result. But this time, not even a single crate is placed in the map beforehand. Instead, I store all possible items in a long, elaborate file containing every parameter required. What's spawned and where it can be placed is now determined by the floor model itself. By understanding the shape of the rooms and where its edges lie allows me to break the whole thing up into rectangles, in which I can spawn whatever I want. And this isn't just for items, but for characters, enemies, weapons, location-specific details, and even the rooms themselves. All these things have their own detailed files documenting every parameter for every permutation possible. I have essentially rewritten the whole thing from scratch. It's still spaghetti code, but is far less stringy than before. These new scripts have improved many things. For example, the rewritten code for choosing a seed and for generating random numbers now does these things more intelligently. In the older code, the slightest fart would greatly alter the generation of locations, and the placement of items and anything else dictated by the seed. But now there will be no such problems. Even the seed itself has changed, now using 8 characters consisting of letters and numbers, meaning that the number of different seeds is now as great as 2.8 trillion. 2.8 trillion different locations and levels. and is now almost entirely generated from that code. In my earlier AIM and training map projects, there were many pre-prepared elements that spawned for different purposes, but now only the weapons and large and complex objects like a store and a Wheel of Fortune are hand-placed. I use far fewer green Gordon Freemans to indicate set spawn points for things, and the bot and player spawns are now fully decided by scripts. Bots can now spawn behind almost every box or tree, but do so only within reason. On the whole, the entire procedural generation process has been greatly improved, but unfortunately, it was not without problems, and some desired mechanics sadly had to be abandoned. I simply could not or did not have time to fully implement everything I would have wanted. For example, I was hoping to use the old split navigation method, but the size of these levels can be so very large, as great as 20,000 by 20,000 units, and splitting a grid of this size drops the game's frame rate down to about 1 frame a second, and so using such a grid system is totally infeasible. I found workarounds by manipulating bots in other ways, but by still using the same scripts. I wanted pistols to have infinite ammo, and for the rest of the weapons to have finite ammunition to use. But unfortunately, CSGO does not allow for you to get or to give the player the required amount of ammo. You can either replenish all of the ammo all at once, or must use other methods, which result in their own exotic bugs. There is an ammo dispenser in the Danger Zone game mode, which would have been ideal, but sadly, it refuses to work in a custom game mode of any sort. Just great. In the end, I opted to give all weapons infinite ammo, which I think worked out for the better, even. Several ability cards that were already fully functioning also fell under the knife, but more on that later. Some mechanics were reworked or completely removed. For example, earlier in development, in order to take a diskette, players needed to have a free inventory slot, which could be obtained by taking any card. I thought that doing it in this way, it would give players more motivation to collect cards, but in practice, this theory never took root. A separate topic for discussion is optimization. Source provides tools for optimizing maps by hiding stuff behind solid walls, but as these levels I was creating comprise entirely of dynamically generated objects, even the walls and floors being such things, optimizing such an environment is a different task entirely. To begin with, I investigated the use of LOD. This stands for level of detail, meaning that things nearby are drawn at a much higher quality and with more polygons, and this quality then gradually drops as the items get further away from the player. Problem is, in CSGO, level of detail doesn't work at all, so I cheated. Many of the generated walls and floors have their own sub-models that determine the detail of these items, so I calculated where the players were in the level, made sure I kept good quality floors and walls in the neighboring regions, and then completely turned off the sub-models in the ones further away. This trick helped a little, but what helped most was just not to render stuff at all. So I resorted to a technology that games from the 90s made very heavy use of. Fog. I also used this on my AIM map, and here, as planned, it entirely removed rooms that did not need to be seen, reminding us again that we are in virtual reality. Many textures had to be compressed, as the map size was getting uncomfortably large, at one point reaching almost 900 megabytes in size. After all this compression, the map is still 700 megabytes, due to the large number of wall models for the farm locations, but once the map file has been archived, it weighs just 300 megabytes. Which is still big enough to break CSGO, and when connecting to a rogue light server for the first time, you may still see the error, failed to find a dedicated server, which actually means that the map is still being downloaded. You can try to change the download server in the Steam settings, but this does not always help. Your best bet is simply to wait, or perhaps to restart Counter-Strike and Steam several times. In general, due to the abundance of dynamic items, I aimed for the frame rates on my maps to be similar to those in the Danger Zone game mode, but it's variable. Sometimes it's higher, other times much lower. It all depends on the bots and on the number of objects around. I'd like to say that the plot was cut due to technological constraints, but the reality is I simply did not have time to come up with something. I even planned to have voice acting like what's heard in the official co-op maps. But alas, in the current version, there is no hint of a plot at all. But the idea was to have something like this. The Phoenix have a secret soldier training program that runs in virtual reality. The operatives were able to steal this data and tried to hack the program. With the help of Convars, a special program called Rogue was developed, which uses most of the stolen data, but much of which can only be obtained by extracting information, and that involves players jumping into the VR simulation and by gaining experience points. Thus, by building this entire special complex, operatives can study the intricate technologies the Phoenix possess by undergoing a mysterious training program in virtual reality. Okay, I think it's time to walk you through the end result. In the beginning, the players don't have a HUD, as they are still in reality. In order to get started, they must get their hands on modern equipment. Yes, Dr. Romanov's glasses are perhaps a strange choice. I had initially planned to make a model of a fully fledged virtual helmet, but I didn't have time to do this. Sorry. Upon picking up Romanov's glasses, players can finally see the HUD and other elements, thanks to the magic of augmented reality. It will highlight and reveal more detail if pointed towards objects, characters, and various hints dotted around the room, which I placed to help the player to get used to this system a little before the experience begins for real. Here we will focus on the most important thing, the leveling room. Subjects gradually level items while looking at this green button, which is definitely not just a large microwave oven. That's all just in your imagination. Each open block opens a new opportunity to get a new item or to open a new category for leveling. In the same room, you can view all the blueprints, booster packs, and ability cards, which, if we also factor in the curse cards, comes to more than 100 in total. I even bought one of them Apple pads to try and help me to draw these things with my crooked little fingers. I'm no artist, but I'm quite proud of how these cards turned out. Coming up with names for cards was its own challenge, because the name should not only reflect the ability it represents, but should also be something that's within my ability to draw. For example, understanding how to draw weakness is more difficult than drawing fragility, or figuring out how to design a card to represent self-flagellation, when there's already another existing card with artwork containing a masochist. I chose to rename this one Empty Deck, since it debuffs your stats based on how many other cards you hold at the time, so you had better hope the rest are empty. Some card names were originally chosen to reference other games, music, films, and media. Problem is, quoting something like the HEV suit from Half-Life is not always the easiest to draw, nor the most intuitive wording to attempt to translate into different languages. I quickly learned that it was best to moderate my usage of niche references, though I did still use I Know Kung Fu. But oh well. After the leveling room, it's time to choose a character. Each have their own stats and unique ability in the form of a special card. Unfortunately, this is one of the most underdeveloped aspects of the game mode. These special cards serve their purpose, but visually they could have been made clearer to display that they've been activated. I really wanted to animate the hands in first person to visually communicate their power to the player, but it would have required time and effort that I couldn't justify. Another problem is the activation itself. Unfortunately, Counter-Strike doesn't have a way to easily track which buttons are pressed. You instead have to track specific actions. So activation of these abilities is represented by the Weapon Inspect function. You press a button, usually F, and the ability is triggered. The problem is that while the player is busy equipping or reloading a weapon, their ability will be disabled since you can't inspect a weapon during these other actions. Which is a shame, since it's at such moments that the special ability could have been the greatest lifesaver. There are 8 characters to choose from, but more were originally planned. 4 of the 8 start unlocked, and the remaining 4 can be unlocked in different categories of the leveling room. Now next, we dive into VR, and this is where the fun begins. In virtual reality, as we go through the level room by room, we'll encounter various enemies, items that we can pick up, shops that we can visit, and the Wheel of Fortune, before ending with a boss fight of sorts. Let's start with items. Ability cards can be either good or cursed. Good ability cards give the player various passive abilities that last the duration of the run. Cursed cards give a negative effect. Such cards can be randomly acquired from the Wheel of Fortune. Sometimes you get good and bad cards together, where you may know what the good card is and you may take a gamble, believing it will outweigh the downsides of whatever the cursed card may be. Some of these have mild effects, others can be pretty devastating. As I said earlier, there are over 100 different cards in this game. I tried to make the abilities as unique and as interesting as possible. Some of the cards did not make it to the current version of the mode, while others were reworked many times. For example, the Dynamo Machine card. This ability was supposed to encourage the player to constantly move, because with each step, he would gain a small amount of HP. But the moment he stops, then his health would rapidly drop down to 1 HP again. I decided to remove this card until I could figure out a better way to balance it. Another interesting card is the Alpinist. This was the very first one that I ever made. It allows the player to climb onto ledges. Initially, the levels were planned to be more vertical, and there would even be some rooms where there would be mini-games, in which the climber ability would have been very helpful. But this ability ended up being handier for other purposes. I ended up giving it to almost all of the bots. Yes, bots can also have their own abilities and stats, just like the players can. The Alpinist ability helped to dislodge bots from potential stuck spots, and also allowed them to navigate taller obstacles. There are also cards for setting fire to things, for slowing stuff down, and even to charm enemies. Some cards allow you to heal more effectively, some change grenades, there are cards to increase the damage of a certain type of weapon, and some may alter your stats and abilities, changing your approach to choosing diskettes. There are many opportunities to create unique feeling character builds in this game mode. Diskettes. These allow you to level your character's main stats. There are 5 core parameters: health, damage, technology, critical damage, and luck. There are others as well, but I'll only discuss these main ones in this video. Health and damage are fairly easy to understand, but others, like luck and especially technology, may not be so immediately understandable. Among other things, luck also affects one of your secondary stats known as critical chance, which determines how likely you are to deal critical damage. It also determines the chance of triggering various unique abilities, like setting fire to people or poisoning them. Luck also helps with the Wheel of Fortune, improves your chances with cases which may be booby-trapped, and also the chance that a cursed card may not work. Now, I've always considered technology to be similar in function to intelligence. It affects your secondary stat of medicine, which affects how much you can heal yourself. For example, if you have a negative medicine stat, then a small first aid kit will only restore 1 HP. I do not recommend that you neglect technology. It also determines the damage that's dealt from grenades and, most importantly, the potency of some card's abilities. Blueprints are basically weapons. You pick up a drawing and you get a gun, or sometimes a few grenades. It's all straightforward. And then there are some collectible items, money, experience points, and first aid kits, which do exactly as you'd expect these sort of things to do. Also worth mentioning are the booster packs. These are kind of like hidden items, which were regularly likened to achievements during this game mode's testing. If you fulfill enough hidden conditions during a level, then you will receive a booster pack that opens a unique card that cannot be obtained in any other way. These first 3 items that I've covered, that being cards, diskettes, and blueprints, can all be obtained in the store, through the Wheel of Fortune, or from various containers that are found in the game's world, both when clearing out a room and on other occasions. The store mechanic was inspired by the feature found in Dead Cells. The player is offered several random items for a certain amount. Later on, players may unlock an ability to re-roll items or to even be able to choose a specific category of items to buy from. The Wheel of Fortune was more inspired by the Isaac slot machine, although for the most part, it just serves to randomly give an item to a player who has a playable coin to spend. There are 12 parts on this wheel, of which only 4 start revealed. There are 2 buttons to control it. One of these improves the wheel by replacing bad sectors with random ones, and if there are none to replace, then it reveals another part of the wheel. As for the second button, that's used to spin the wheel itself. There are a lot of containers scattered through the game. Some will appear after you've cleared out a room as a kind of reward, while others are in special areas or simply well hidden within the environments. I have added some powerful features to make the game feel fairer. For example, if a player is about to die, they will instead be left with 1 HP, giving them a final chance to avoid a game over. There is also an instant reload mechanic, which the player can activate by pulling off a melee kill, after which they will then find their weapon has been reloaded. And when playing with 2 or 3 players, you can revive a friend by sacrificing half of your current health, which is then transferred to them instead. It is worth noting that the balance of all these elements was, and remains, a massive challenge. I have made a real fun mess with all of the different gameplay mechanics that are going on here. But even with all these things in place, the fact it still took me so many attempts to reach the final location in the game is probably a sign that the map will still be able to offer a challenge of some sort. Unfortunately, this project is only about 80% done. The gameplay mechanics work, but I'm not yet ready to consider it finished, despite it perhaps looking as if it is on the surface. The enemy types leave a lot to be desired. There currently aren't as many enemy types as I would have liked, and the bots are limited in their capabilities. Some enemy types were born from borrowing and combining several different ideas. For example, my friend, Ansemist, released a video about hitboxes, which helped give me the idea of a scarecrow class of enemy. Since his hitboxes eventually become so small, it discourages mindless spray and pray, and I hope will make defeating him more about precision shots and smart tactics. For instance, you can simply set him on fire instead. This enemy type was initially a bubble of some sort, but was then replaced with straw, before the bubble guy returned, but only for later acts of the player's quest. In the early sections of the game, you'll most likely encounter farmers armed with various weapons, like a torch that can set the player on fire, and some snowballs that can blind and slow the player down. Combined, these 3 different types of enemies are intended to challenge the player in various ways, and to encourage them to move about, and to try and shoot more accurately, and to have to make decisions about who to attack first and with which kind of weapons. I don't want players to just run and gun blindly. There are also different variations of enemies with firearms. One particularly noteworthy enemy is Glitch. This was one of the first unique enemies that I made. He has a regularly changing character model and the ability to teleport to different locations. I originally considered this kind of feature for a boss fight, but decided against that, and right now only have two types of bosses that you'll encounter in the game. I want to make each boss a little more interesting than your standard helicopter boss or another type of bullet sponge vehicle sort that you tend to see in other games. I will not describe the bosses in detail, but for each of them I envisioned unique mechanics to try and make the fights look and feel interesting to play. The procedurally generated maps threw up many different bugs at various stages of development. Sometimes I forgot to prescribe the necessary parameters for certain objects, which led to funny situations, and sometimes the mode simply threw out unknown errors, which were far harder to diagnose. In the current version, for example, there is one bug that I can't fix in any way. When a player enters the first location with bots, the round can restart, thereby throwing the player into reality again, after which the game will work as normal. But why this restart occurs in the first place, I have no idea. Lighting. Oh, for the love of all that is holy in this godforsaken land, the problems I had with lighting. I do not recommend anyone to deal with dynamic lights in CSGO. It is the most disgusting thing. I tried to add the tiniest little light to the first location, and the result of this nightmare, unfortunately, will immediately catch your eye. In general, shoddy indoor lighting is the main reason why many of the locations are in outdoor spaces. I had to abandon some locations just because of the lighting, which is a pity. I really wanted to generate subway passages and to have office complexes where the player would have to fight through several floors of a half-constructed building in the styles of Office and Vertigo. Five locations were originally planned, with one of those being secret, only to be unlocked after certain conditions. But it just took too much time. So I opted for three locations with three boss types, which then became just two because I didn't even have time to do that. One of the locations is around the remnants of a farm, in which you'll need to fight the farmers and to get through the basements and large fields filled with hay, sheds, machinery, and various other props. The second location is something like a forest. These spaces are more claustrophobic, the visibility poorer, and the enemies more aggressive. The third location, let's just call it Air. She's a little unfinished. I've got the floor models and connecting bridges ready for her, but that's about it. I started making unique enemies and even had plans for a third boss type, but like I said, I didn't have time to complete that. Which gets us onto something I've been meaning to talk about. I called Counter-Strike 2 the main villain earlier, and I need to explain why. The fact is that some features of the Source engine, on which key mechanics of this game mode are based, simply do not work in Source 2. The trick with rewriting health cannot be done, which is the first major blow to this mod. There is no way to save files, since the console commands do not work, and to be honest, I doubt they ever will, which is yet another blow to this game mode. And the killing blow is that Counter-Strike 2 uses the scripting language Lua, while in CSGO, mappers have been using Squirrel for 10 years. It was here that I again felt dead inside, reflecting upon the 50,000 lines of code needed to create this mod. And honestly, now I simply do not know what awaits this project. Of course, having access to the Source 2 tools, I will see what can be done, but so far it doesn't look hopeful. In fact, I'd even say it's hopeless. I really want for the developers of Counter-Strike 2 to take notice of this project, to add Squirrel as a scripting language, and to allow for the same changes to HP and for the inclusion of save files. But who am I kidding? So that's why I decided to release this game mode as it is. There may be some bugs and crashes, I may not have had the time to add some enemy and boss types, and there isn't an established ending. But it's still a lot of fun to play, especially since the map is flexible enough to be played either solo or with up to three players working together. There is a lot to discover and to find in it, and I am distraught that this idea, of which has been my dream for 3 years, will now most likely sink into oblivion. Huge thanks to my friends.
Ensimist, Deposit, Console, Gabe Follower, Yurina Gribetsky, Nexus, Aquarius, Hell, Bars, Morozov.
Thank you so much for helping me to test the map, for suggesting ideas, and for giving me encouragement and support when the Source engine did not. And thanks also to you, mysterious viewer, for listening to this nonsense from a madman until the very end. I'm open to suggestions on how to improve this mod, and I hope you enjoy playing it. Have fun.